Yellowstone National Park is known for its incredible natural beauty, pristine wildlife, and of course, very cool geysers. So the idea of spoiling that in any way seems outrageous. But a few kilometers underneath it all, things are hot enough to melt rock, and that heat can do a lot for us. I'm talking about geothermal power, which is possibly the cleanest kind of energy you can make. Now, building a massive geothermal power station in our nation's first national park might not be high on your list of good ideas, but it is on NASA's. In fact, a team of NASA scientists has already drafted a plan for how we could drill for geothermal energy in Yellowstone. And please, put down your pitchforks and hear us out. Because as ludicrous as it sounds, drilling into our most famous national park could be super important for another reason that has nothing to do with energy. Now, the primary reason people are interested in drilling into volcanically active regions is because the inside of our planet is an enormous reservoir of heat. And there are two reasons for that. For one, it just takes a while to cool down when you're a giant rock that started out as a ball of magma. And on top of that, there are all these radioactive elements deep inside of Earth producing even more heat as they decay. So for every kilometer down you drill, rocks get hotter by about 30 degrees Celsius. In volcanically active regions, this heat from down under comes up pretty close to the surface. Sometimes a little bit leaks out in the form of hot springs, geysers, or volcanoes. And engineers have gotten really good at harnessing geothermal energy. Today, we have geothermal plants all over the world. They generally sit on top of active volcanic regions over areas called geothermal reservoirs. These are places where hot water or steam gets trapped in the rocks and heats up. Sometimes that hot fluid escapes through those hot springs or geysers I mentioned, but sometimes it's just trapped down there. You typically need to drill a couple of kilometers or more to reach a geothermal reservoir. But once you do, you've got a free source of steam or hot water at your service. And there's a lot that you can do with steam and hot water. You can funnel it straight into places that need heat, like homes or greenhouses. Or if it's hot enough, you can use steam to spin a turbine and make electricity. The thing is, as good as we have gotten at harnessing this heat from the Earth, geothermal energy still just makes up a sliver of the world's renewable energy. And places like Iceland show us just how much potential we may be wasting. The island gets the vast majority of its energy from renewable sources, and most of that comes from geothermal plants. Plus, 9 out of 10 houses use geothermal heat to stay warm, so they barely even need to produce their own heat. There is the problem of the volcanoes, but they figure out how to work around that. Now, Iceland sits right on top of the Mid-Atlantic Rift, which is full of steaming holes belching up hot fluids from deep in the Earth. So their geothermal energy is basically right on tap almost everywhere you need it. North America is no Iceland, but here in the US, we do have our own volcanically active regions that we could be making much more use of, like Yellowstone. And I hear you, putting a power plant in the middle of our national treasure doesn't sound like a winning idea. And I'll be honest, moves like this have not always gone well for other countries. Exhibit A, New Zealand. Decades ago, New Zealand had more than 200 active geysers in areas called geyser basins. They were full of colorful hot springs, rare plants and animals, and of course, plenty of geysers. Locals and tourists used to go and relax in hot pools and spas. It was a really special place. Then, in the 1940s, the demand for electricity started outpacing their supply, and the New Zealand government found itself in a pinch. So they started thinking about drilling into geyser basins to produce geothermal power. In 1953, they got the go-ahead to build their first geothermal plant in an area called the Wairiki Basin. 5 years later, it started producing electricity, and soon the government was plopping down power plants in other geyser basins too. But even within the first year they started drilling into the Wairiki Basin, there were already signs of trouble. Geysers were spewing less water, eruptions got shorter, and happened less often. Within 15 years, the geysers and hot springs had all run dry. The stunning landscape fizzled out till all that was left was a giant patch of steaming mud. And the drilling was almost certainly to blame, because geysers are finicky. They need a source of water, plenty of pressure, and a way to escape, or you don't get the geyser. And all that drilling threw that delicate balance out of whack. One problem was that it released pressure from the geothermal reservoir, which made the water boil off instead of spouting out. At the same time, the water level in the reservoir dropped, so it was no longer welling up through the usual vents. But the damage was irreversible. possible. Scientists aren't sure why, but they think it may be that the plumbing got clogged with minerals, so that even if the reservoir filled back up, water could no longer escape the same way. And New Zealand wasn't a fluke. Something similar happened in Iceland, where another geyser basin ran mostly dry after people began geothermal drilling. Today, many of the world's geysers have run dry thanks to human meddling. So Yellowstone is actually one of the few geyser basins left anywhere. And after all of these whoopsies that left a bunch of dead geyser basins in their wake, Yellowstone kind of seems like a place to leave alone. I mean, it's Yellowstone, the first ever national park and one of the most stunning natural wonders in the world, which is also famous for its geysers. A team of scientists at NASA suggested that drilling into Yellowstone might be exactly what we need to do. And the reason is that in the case of Yellowstone, disrupting the geothermal conditions underground might really be a good thing? The NASA scientists pitching this plan actually aren't focused on geothermal energy and how it could help us fight climate change. Like, they see that part as cool and all, but their goal isn't for power. They're worried about the fact that Yellowstone will eventually blow up in a colossal explosion that could plunge Earth into a volcanic winter and change this planet forever. All those fun geysers sometimes make us forget that Yellowstone is sitting on top of a humongous volcano. The park itself is a caldera, the kind of volcano that collapses in on itself after an eruption instead of forming a cone. While that volcano has not erupted in over 600,000 years, it is still very much active. It's erupted 3 times in the last 2.1 million years, and it will inevitably blow up again, and we don't know exactly when that will be. So NASA figured there was no point in just waiting around. They thought, why not see if there was some way to engineer our way out of that calamity? And the solution they came up with was drill into it. The Yellowstone caldera sits on top of a massive magma chamber, an underground region full of rock, magma, crystals, and a bunch of different fluids and gases. According to NASA, we can think of this whole region as a kind of leaky bathtub, where the faucet is flowing, but there's a small leak at the bottom. In this case, we've got heat from deep inside the Earth flowing through the faucet into the bathtub, and we've got some of that heat escaping to the surface. That's the leak. The heat is mainly carried out by water that bubbles out or bursts through the surface. Thanks to this leak, the bathtub can take hundreds of thousands of years to fill up, but whenever it does, the heat in the magma chamber crosses a breaking point and the volcano erupts. So if we could increase the size of the leak so that it kept up with the flow of the faucet, the tub would never overflow. And that is the crux of NASA's idea. Unsurprisingly, releasing heat from a supervolcano isn't easy, but one way to do it could be to drill pairs of wells all around the edge of the magma chamber. You'd also need to fracture the rock around these wells. Then you could inject water into one of the wells and let it seep into those fractures, where it would draw heat from the surrounding rock. And finally, you would draw water back up through a second well, helping heat escape the magma chamber faster than it did before. The NASA team estimated that by increasing the rate of heat escape by about a third, we could stave off an eruption indefinitely. And as a bonus for potentially dodging a global catastrophe, you could use all of that heat to generate electric power, and for pretty cheap. The amount of power we could generate would depend on how exactly we extract that heat, but one group of researchers has found that in theory, Yellowstone could generate enough electricity to power the entire United States, basically indefinitely. And the even better good news is, this method would still preserve the geysers, at least in theory. By drilling around the edges of the magma chamber, engineers could leave the geothermal reservoir intact, which would be safer for the geysers and hot springs coming out of it. There's always some risk, because again, geysers are finicky, so even drilling around them and removing heat could throw things off. And then there's the fact that putting an industrial plant in the middle of our national treasure is not likely to be hugely popular, no matter how much good it might do. It's also worth saying that indigenous people have lived or traveled through Yellowstone for millennia, including Blackfeet, Crow, Shoshone, and Nez Perce communities and tribes, so those groups deserve to have a say in any major development plans. For now, drilling into Yellowstone is also illegal. In 1970, Congress passed the Geothermal Steam Act, making it the law that we have have to protect geothermal features like Yellowstone's geysers. So NASA's idea is more of a thought experiment than anything else. And as tempting as it might be, there are no plans to put it into action anytime soon. Though if the basin starts to swell, we should start to think about it. At the root of this thought experiment, there's a question about what we are willing to give up to save ourselves from doom one way or another. On the one hand, there's the very straightforward doom of a supervolcanic eruption, and on the other, there's the way more complex doom of the climate crisis. But there's also the question of how to put a value on the things we cherish, like Yellowstone National Park. And while there are no plans to drill into Yellowstone right now, that question of whether that sacrifice could ever be worth making is definitely worth thinking about.